you're an amazing God, but it's pretty scary. You see the depths of my heart? Really? You see the depths of my heart? God, I would really like to know today that you love me in the depths of my heart. I mean, you would think I would have it figured out by now, right? All of my life, I've been surrounded by people who are pretty persuaded of God's love. And it was deeply ingrained in me with all those, you know, hymns that you sing in children's church. Jesus loves, you know that song? Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves the little children. I sang those songs. I believed, you know, Jesus loves me. But I got older, and I don't know. The more I know I'm harder to love than I should be. Don't say anything about that. I mean, truth be told, I don't even love myself a lot of times. So, does God really love me in the deep? I mean, I believe, right? I mean, I preached in India about the love of God. I believe. I especially believe God is powerful because I just look around creation and I know it took a really powerful God to create the things, the sunset. I mean, it just takes a lot for that kind of power to be on display. And I really believe that God, you know, doesn't make mistakes, because who wants to worship a God that makes mistakes all the time? I don't want to worship that God. And if I'm terribly transparent, I'll tell you, I even believe, don't you, about the cross and the resurrection? Because there's so much evidence. There's so much evidence that Jesus really did die and he rose from the dead. And the truth is, that's supposed to persuade me of the love of God. I mean, if Jesus died on the cross for my sins, that ought to prove something. And yet still, sometimes, I don't know, I'm sure you probably never wonder about it, but sometimes I wonder about it. Do you wonder about it?
I have.
You have? Not all the time like me, just occasionally. You're much more spiritual than I am. That's fine. No problem. You see, here's my thinking. If God loves me, I mean, if he sees the deepest parts of my heart, but he still loves me, why did my roof cave in during all this recent rain while I was away, you know? Doesn't even make sense, right? Or to be more precise, if God really loves me, why did Beck's mom die of Alzheimer's when we so believed that she was going to be healed? Now her dad's got cancer, right? How's that for a battle, Tim? You know, does God love me whenever, I mean, even mom and dad is having treatments now for that. And so I get that God is powerful. I get that God doesn't make mistakes. I even believe with all my heart that Jesus died on the cross and he rose again. But what I really need to know, more than a song, more than a Bible study, I just want to know, Jesus, do you love me in the depths of my heart? Do you know everything about me and still love me? I've come today to ask you to not cast away your confidence. Because if you don't, you will reap. Stand together to honor the reading of God's word. This is our theme verse for 2018. I'd like you to read it with enthusiasm out of Hebrews 10. Everyone together, are you ready? Let's say it. So do not. You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive. You will receive what he has promised. And then to begin our 3-week series called Relentless, we're going to, we're going to begin in Luke chapter 5. On one occasion, Jesus was preaching to the crowds on the shore of Lake Galilee. There was a vast multitude of people pushing to get close to Jesus to hear the word of God.
Jesus noticed two fishing boats at the water's edge with the fishermen nearby rinsing their nets. Jesus climbed into the boat belonging to Simon Peter and asked him, "Let me use your boat. Push it off a short distance away from the shore so I can speak to the crowds." Jesus sat down in the boat, taught the people from the boat. When he had finished, he said to Peter, "Now, row out to the deep water to cast your nets and you'll have a great catch." "Master," Peter replied, "we've just come back from fishing all night and didn't catch a thing. But if you insist, we'll go out again and let down our nets because of your word." When they pulled up their nets, they were shocked. They were shocked to see a huge catch of fish, so much that their nets were ready to burst. They waved to their business partners in the other boat for help. They ended up completely filling both boats with fish until their boats began to sink. When Simon Peter saw this astonishing miracle, he knelt at Jesus' feet and begged him, "Go away, Master. Go away from me, for I am a sinful man." Simon Peter and the other fishermen, including his fishing partners, Jacob and John, the sons of Zebedee, were awestruck over the miracle catch of fish. Jesus answered, "Do not yield to your fear, Simon Peter. From now on, you will catch men for their salvation." After pulling their boats to the shore, they left everything behind and followed Jesus. And this, dear friends, is God's word. You may be seated. So the next 3 weeks, we're going to consider the relentless love. The relentless love of God. And I think it's important to understand Easter in the context of love, to use Paul's language, the great love with which he loved us. We're going to journey over the next 3 weeks through Easter with a guy who might win the contest for the most challenging person in the world to love. You probably have somebody else in mind, but I'm going to stick with Peter. Jesus loved Peter, and Peter was really hard. He was really hard to love. He was cocky. He was impetuous. He had a dirty mouth. He cursed. He smelled like fish. He was violent. He was a racist. I mean, there were 100 reasons not to like Peter, but Jesus did more than like Peter. He relentlessly loved Peter, and watch this, formed Peter into the main leader of the church. Jesus kept pushing and pulling on Peter's heart until the guy changed. Well, today's episode begins on the shore of Lake Galilee. We'll see that when we go together in October to Israel, the Sea of Galilee, the Lake of Galilee. It's also known as Tiberias. It's also known as Gennesaret. But basically, it's the lake. And he's out. Jesus is teaching, and there's a standing room crowd who are pressing up to try to hear Jesus. And the Bible says, verse 1 says, they're listening to the word of God. Now, they're not listening to a Bible study from the word of God. They're not listening to a sermon about the word of God. They're listening to the word of God made flesh. They're listening to the, "In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God." They're listening to the word by which all things were made that were made, and without him nothing was made that was made. That's the word that they're listening to. The word is beginning to unfurl his glory and his beauty and his love in their neighborhood. In their neighborhood. And they're listening. There's always a crowd when Jesus is talking, it seems, and Jesus is actually going to set up his headquarters right here on the shores of the Sea of Galilee. Jesus is going to do over half of his miracles right there on the shoreline around the Sea of Galilee. And it's interesting to me when I study to realize that the Sea of Galilee is the lowest lake in the world. 700 feet below sea level is the Sea of Galilee. And I'm probably making to all you theologians will go, that's not even in the Bible. You're just imagining that. Okay, I'm just imagining this. But does anybody else believe that Jesus often chooses the lowest places of our life to reveal his highest love? I mean, maybe it's just coincidence, and maybe you're not even in a low place today, you know, but these guys, Peter begins his journey into the love of God in one of the lowest places, you know, it's the Sea of Galilee. And not just that, he's fished all night, and how many fish did he catch? He didn't catch any. And I don't know if that seems like a big deal for you, but for a professional fisherman not to catch any fish, and not only that, he's cleaned his nets, he stretched them out. I've done that before, and that's a pretty hard job. So Peter is part of the crowd, listening, but frustrated. He's listening, but he's frustrated. And the people are frustrated as well because they can't hear Jesus. They can't get close enough to listen to his words. And there are two boats that are handy. Jesus notices, the Bible says Jesus notices two boats that are handy. He chooses one, and when he chooses the boat, the relentless love of God begins. When he chooses the boat, the relentless love of God begins. Now, choosing a boat is not a big deal, except it is a big deal. No conversation about the boat, no, you know, lease agreement, no request, may I use your boat. Jesus just gets in the boat. Now, you can try that sometime if you want. You could try that in the parking lot after the second service today. I mean, Jaydan needs a vehicle for forgiven felons. Jaydan, just go get in somebody's car. Pick a Mercedes if you don't mind. Pick an Infiniti and just say, the Lord has need of it, you know, and see how that works out for you. I'm just saying Jesus got in the boat. He got in the boat, and then as he's in the boat, he asks Peter. He's in the boat and he asks Peter. Now remember, please, that Jesus created the trees for the wood for the boat. He created the trees for the wood for the boat, but he's asking Peter to get involved. Peter, push out a little, he says. Now, I've heard sermons all my life about how Jesus needed Peter's boat to get the word into the community, but I remember that Jesus is the guy who actually walks on the water, so he really didn't need the boat. He could have just taken about 20 yards of walk out on the water. He could have hovered over the water and preached. He didn't need Jesus' boat. Peter needed Jesus in his boat. So Peter pushes out a little. And people hear the word of God. And that's when the drama begins. I just need to pause because I'm losing some of your attention. Do you believe God's love for you is relentless? Somebody say amen. Yeah, Jesus tells Peter, hey, Peter, it's time to fish again. I want you to go deep. And I know you tried last night. Didn't work out for you, Peter. Didn't come together for you, Peter. But would you just be willing to try again? And I feel like that's a prophetic word for somebody in the 11 o'clock service. I know you tried and you failed, but it's time to try again. How about that? It's time to try again. And it's extremely counterintuitive because he tells Peter to go in the daylight, in the deep water. And you've heard me preach this before, that you know, you don't catch fish in the daylight in the deep water. You catch fish at nighttime in the shallow water. And Peter starts pushing back. He's like, Jesus, there's no fish to be caught in the daylight, in the deep water. We fished all night. There's no fish. And we respect you as a rabbi. We hope someday to learn some spiritual things from you. But Rabbi, when it comes to fishing, you're not that smart. And you got to give Peter credit because even though it seemed hopeless, even though catching fish seemed hopeless, because the one doing the talking was the word, Peter obeyed. He barely obeyed, but I don't know if he barely obeyed, but sometimes barely obeying is enough to get the momentum started. See? So he barely obeyed. And I don't know what seems hopeless for you today. I don't know what seems so empty that it'll never be filled. I don't know what you've tried that turned into nothing, but I'm here to proclaim over you that even though last night was an empty net, this is a nevertheless moment in your life. And anyway, let me get to the sermon. Peter fished again. And this time so many fish. So many. I mean, I've caught fish before. I never caught enough fish that the boat starts to sink. And he is in the middle of the greatest fishing day ever. He's a professional fisherman, and there is so much joy. Can't you imagine? There is so much adrenaline. There is so much. Can you believe? I mean, his business partners are coming over. All the boats. There's too many fish for one boat. All the boats are gathering, and oh, the fish are slippery and slimy, and it's so wonderful. The smell. I can smell it right now. It's just wonderful. And in the middle of the ecstasy of the catching of the fish, Peter freezes. And he has the strangest response. His response is not, "Thank you, Jesus." His response is not, "Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord." His response is not, "When are we going to go fishing again, Jesus?" His response is, "Would you leave now? Depart from me, Jesus. I'm a sinful man." But Jesus did not depart. And that's when the relentless love of God began in Peter's life. So this episode reveals basically four aspects of the relentless love of God. We can do it quickly. Number one, there's the approach of God's love. The approach of God's love. Jesus climbed into the boat belonging to Peter, and he asked him, "Let me use your boat. Push it off a short distance from the shore so I can speak to the crowds." So the question is, how do you get someone to believe that you love them? And the answer is, you approach them. See, Beck was the librarian at the college that we attended together, which became huge incentive for me to study. I was in the research section every evening. You could find me in the library. Why? Because that was my approach, you see. One day, heaven's counsel emerged with a plan. The conversation in heaven was, you know, we love the humans even though they've turned away from us, so here's what we'll do. We'll find a teenage girl in Palestine. We'll enter her virgin womb. That's what the Holy Spirit can do. And in heaven, they said, we can approach them in a way that they can understand us. We'll approach them by coming near. We'll come near their taxation. We'll come near their injustice. We'll come near their burdens. I mean, let's feel their loneliness. Let's feel their fears and their tears, because they've been living with fishless nights and empty nets. All of their relationships are breaking down. Let's go into their neighborhood and bless them. That was the conversation in heaven. Let's show them fish. Let's show them forgiveness. Let's show them a future. Let's rescue them from slavery. Let's meet the demands of justice, since they can't do it for themselves. Let's show them our glory, and then let's ask them to live in our glory. Oh, church, what kind of a king, what kind of a God, what kind of a creator asks to use your boat when he gave you the wood in the first place? And the answer is, only a God that is approaching you. He's approaching you. This is why the story of Jesus is the most important story in the universe, because the story of Jesus is God's approach. It's the love of God approaching you. Last week we talked about Jacob, and oh, what an empty net story his life is, right? I mean, all he wanted was a blessing, and Jacob said, "I need a better life, I need a better life. So I'll deceive my dad to get his money and earn favor with my mom." That didn't work out. So Jacob said, I'll marry beautiful Rachel and we'll have babies together, and that didn't work out. And he said, I'll have a successful business and then everybody will love me, and that didn't work out. And then he said, I'll give gifts to my brother fire, so he won't want to kill me. And the point is, all of Jacob's life, he's looking for love. All of Jacob's life, he believes there's something so good that it will eventually satisfy him. And every time he thought he had it in his hands, it turned into pixie dust. It just went away. And then one night in a very low place, God approached Jacob, and Jacob wrestled with God. And at the end of the evening, Jacob said, I'm not letting you go until you bless me. And that's the blessing that worked out for Jacob. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. I'm talking about the God of creation. I'm talking about the God who never makes mistakes. I'm talking about the God who is so brilliant in his beauty that no eye could ever behold him, has approached us in the person of Jesus Christ. I have a friend that I've invited to church a number of times, and she hasn't come yet. She keeps promising to come. Last week she couldn't come because her grandfather and her father are in prison, and it was her day to go visit them. And the week before that, she couldn't come because she's a single mom and her baby was sick. And every week, something comes up and she's frustrated and she's hopeless. But I'm willing to be obnoxious with her because I'm not trying to get her to come to my church. I realized a few weeks ago that through me, God is approaching her with a relentless love. And I'm so thankful that the relentless love of God does not stay up in heaven and shout, good luck finding your blessing. Good luck finding hope. I hope you come across what you're looking for. That's not what he said. He said, I am the way. I'm coming into your prisons. I'm coming into your despair. I'm coming into your sick babies. I'm coming into your minimum wage job. I'm just asking you to push out a little so we can get this thing started. If you'll just push out a little, it's the beginning of a life you never imagined. Number two aspect of the relentless love of God is the nature of God's love. And I just don't know a better word. It's grace. The nature of God's love is grace. It says when they pulled up their nets, they were shocked. They were awestruck over the miracle catch. Now, why were they surprised? Why were they shocked? Well, the answer obviously is because they knew those fish were not supposed to be there. Peter's a professional fisherman. He knows where to catch fish, how to catch fish. But these fish did not come into Peter's boat because he was using a new bait or because, you know, an electronic fish finder finally started working. No, sir, he knew those fish were a gift. A gift. And they were shocked not just because it was a couple of fish. They were shocked at the astonished at the abundance of the fish. So many that the nets begin to break. The boats begin to sink. Can I just say this? If it's not amazing, it's not grace. Do you remember that opening scene of La Mis when Jean Valjean had been freed from prison and he needed a place to stay, and he ended up staying at the Catholic priest's home, and during the night he stole the silver from the priest and assaulted the priest? And when Jean Valjean was caught, he had broken parole. When he was caught, you know, he was brought back in front of the priest, and the humble priest shocked them all. He said, oh, it's true. I gave this as a gift. And Jean Valjean, you forgot the candlesticks. Put these in your back as well. Did you see that? In case you didn't, I brought it to you. So here we have it. All right.
Monsignor, we have your silver. We caught this man red-handed.
He had the nerve to say you gave him this.
deserve it. That's just the nature of God's love. It's a grace. What if, I mean, I'm just, this is imagination, but what if the net breaking fish had become a prophetic signal to Peter? It's like, Peter, do you see all those fish? That's the amount of times I'm going to say this over you. Your sin will not stop me from loving you. I mean, Peter put others down. He boasted. He freaked out in the storm. He almost drowned. He slept when he should have been praying. He rebuked the eternal plan of God. He couldn't cast out the demon. He cut off a guy's ear. He denied Jesus three times. And I feel like, I mean, I'm just imagining, but Jesus is saying, Peter, do you see all those fish? Each of those fish represents the time that I'm going to have mercy toward you. I'm going to forgive you. It doesn't matter. I know that some... times I feel like, God, you must get tired of forgiving me for the same thing over and over and over and over again. And I'm just preaching to myself, but I'm preaching to you as well. The nature of God's love is relentless grace. Relentless grace. And then thirdly, there's the fear of love. I'll wind this up quickly. There's the fear of love. Depart from me, said Peter. Verse 10, do not yield to your fear, Peter, because here's the, this is the heartbeat of relentless love in the middle of this magnificent catch of fish. Peter gets afraid. And why does he get afraid? Because he's brilliant. He's brilliant. He understands exactly what's going on. You see, Peter has just met his new reality. Peter recognizes that if there's a guy who can see the fish under the water, then he can see into the deepest secrets of my soul. He can see past all of my masks and all of my poses. If those fish are exposed to Jesus, so am I. Peter's deepest fear and ours begins to rise. Because we learn in kindergarten, if someone knows our secrets, they're not going to love us. And so Peter's deepest instinct is the same as ours. We got to hide. We have to hide behind our boasting, hide behind our skills, hide behind our tough persona, hide who you really are. Because if anyone finds the real you, you're going to be lonely. Of course, to have all these fish, that's a wonderful thing. I mean, limitless fish, who wouldn't want that? But Peter knows it's too good to be true. It's not going to last because he's too disqualified to stay in the boat with Jesus. I mean, Peter's based his whole life on fishing. He's the guy the kids ask every morning, where are the fish, Uncle Peter? You know, he's probably produced his own outdoor fishing television show. He's got his own brand of bait, I'm sure. But in the middle of this astonishing gift of fish, Peter is exposed. He pushes back so hard because his thinking is, if I hang out with this guy, I'm not going to be in charge anymore. If I hang out with Jesus, I am not going to be the smartest guy in the room. I'm going to be constantly feeling what a failure I am. No one will say anymore, Peter, what a great fisherman you are, because Jesus has shown up, and obviously, Peter, you're not a great fisherman. You see, Jesus is confronting Peter's whole identity. The whole identity of Peter is being challenged by a rabbi who happens to be the greatest fisherman in the world. Now, I'm going to close with this. There are two parts to Christian love. Two parts. The first is that part nobody likes. It's the part that exposes you. It's the part that breaks through the hiding places. Remember what sin means? It means you're missing the mark. And when we decided that we could do life better without God, fish on our own, you know, in the night, in the shallow, when we decided we could do it without Jesus, the level of our life diminished. You see, church, we're supposed to catch fish. I thought all the men would say amen there at the very least, or some of the ladies. We're supposed to live in beauty and strength and dominion and joy. We are not supposed to live in despair and frustration and loneliness. But when Jesus shows up, he shows us how our life is missing the mark. When Jesus approaches, we end up knowing what Peter knows, that our life is supposed to be better than it is, that we're supposed to be better than we are. Peter's like, I pretended to be a great fisherman, but now I know I've missed the mark. And the question is it cruel or kind to expose your life as living in a low place when you can actually be living in a high place? Is it cruel or is it kind? Because the second part of Christian love is basically this. The second part is when Jesus says to Peter, Peter, I am not leaving you.
Peter, I am not going to depart. I'm staying because I've come into your life to show you the possibilities and the beauty and the power. I'm going to get you to a high place, but you're going to have to depend on me. I'm not going to depart from you, Peter. I'm going to love you relentlessly. And so he says, Peter, don't yield to your fear. And the last point, which I'm sure I'll work in somewhere in the rest of the series, is the vision for relentless love. The vision for relentless love. It says, from now on, you'll catch men for their salvation. You see, the story ends, but it's actually the beginning of Peter's pursuit of relentless love. I love the idea that Peter, the King James Version actually says, Peter forsook everything. He left the blessing, he left the fish, he left the boats, he left everything to follow the source of the blessing. Are you getting this? The thing that he had trusted in, the thing that he had counted on for his whole identity, he says, I see now that that's really not what I need to build my life on. And he turned and he began to follow Jesus. And that's how you become a follower of Jesus. You stop trusting the things that you've been trusting in, and you start trusting in the love of God that has approached you through the person of Jesus Christ. This is a really good sermon. Somebody ought to say amen. 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 So I try to think about when did the relentless love of God first begin to operate in my life? And I know that even before I was in my mother's womb, God was singing love songs over me. I understand that. But sometimes it takes something to awaken us to it. And I was awakened to the love of God as a child and different. But really the thing that the moment the trajectory really changed in my soul was when I was pastoring in Alabama. And you've heard Beck and I talk about our troubled relationship in the early days. You know, we were pastoring a church and we weren't doing good in our marriage at all. I mean, we were pastoring a church. We were treating one another really poorly, and we were hiding. We'd put on masks for Sunday morning. And don't look at me like that. I'll just go to this side over here. We were just pretending, you know. But when we got home, it was terrible. And there was a lady in our church. Her name was Sherry. And really, by the Holy Spirit, the Lord showed Sherry, maybe you didn't have to have that much discernment, but the Lord showed Sherry that we were in trouble, and she persistently approached. She kept pushing her way into Beck's life. Beck didn't even want to hang out with her, because you don't want to hang out with people when you got secrets. So Beck didn't want to hang out with her. She kept pushing, pushing, pushing. And finally, one day, Sherry said, Beck, I know what's going on in your marriage. I know that you and Jim are struggling. And our secrets were exposed. But this lady did the most amazing thing. Even though she knew our secrets, she didn't pull away. She didn't tell everybody. She didn't condemn us. She actually invited Beck over to her home, and they prayed, and deliverance began. And that's really what began the healing of our marriage. But it dawned on me. I remember awakening to this reality. I was like, are you kidding me? Here's somebody who knows our flaws, but loves us anyway. It was the most humiliating and wonderful moment. Here's someone who knows my flaws, but stays. And of course, now I know that it wasn't just her love. It was the love of Jesus coming through her, relentlessly coming through her. And I guess it's a privilege today just to preach to you that it is not possible for Jesus to love you more than he's loving you right now. It's just not possible. He loves you to the uttermost. And even if you've got secrets, and even if you've got masks, and even if you've got failures, and even if you spent all night fishing and you caught no fish, and even if it seems hopeless, I'm just here to say the relentless love of God
has approached you through the person of Jesus. And if you'll just push out a little, you don't have to speak in tongues today. You don't have to walk on water or cure cancer today. Just push out a little and see what God will do. Just barely obey and see what God will do. Let's pray. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Our closing prayer is going to be offered to anyone who would be courageous enough to say, Pastor, I know I've missed the mark. And I believe that Jesus is approaching me to give me his eternal life. Today, I'm going to do what Peter did. I'm going to turn from the things I've been trusting in, and I'm going to trust in Jesus. I'm going to follow him. There's a lot I don't understand, but that's okay. I'm just going to stop trusting in the things I've been trusting in. I'm going to trust in Jesus. If that fits your heart, I want to pray for you today. Or maybe there's someone here today who would say, Pastor, I frankly just need to recommit. I've been hiding. I've been in a low place. But I don't want to keep living without the assurance of God's love. I'm ready to reconnect my heart to the heart of hearts, the ceaseless, reckless love of Jesus. I want that. I'm going to recommit my life to the Lord. Or maybe there's someone here that could be very specific and say, okay, Pastor, there is something I am trusting in. Maybe it's a career, maybe it's a relationship, maybe it's an ambition, whatever it is, but there's something I'm trusting in, and I feel the Holy Spirit saying it's time for you to trust in Jesus. If any of that fits your heart, either you say, Pastor, today you can pray for me because I'm admitting that I missed the mark and I need eternal life. Or you can say, Pastor, I understand about Jesus, but I'm disconnected. I want to reconnect. I want to recommit my life to the Lord. Or Pastor, there's something very specific in my life, and I've been trusting in that. But today I'm going to trust in Jesus. If any of that fits your heart, heads are bowed, eyes are closed, would you just lift your hand all over the sanctuary? Thank you. Thank you. Thanks for being honest. Got to be honest with God if you're going to get in here. Just lifting your hand and saying, I'm going to push out a little. I'm going to push out a little. Is there anyone else? Thank you. Thank you up in the theater seats. I see you guys. Thank you. Thank you so much. Listen, I don't want to embarrass you. I certainly don't want to take us past when we need to be here, but it's a very important moment in your life. This is what happened for me and Beck. Somebody sees your flaws, but he doesn't leave. If you raised your hand, or you should have, but you didn't, would you just join me here at the front and let me pray for you? Just don't look around to the left or the right, just stand up right now. Come here to the front so I can pray for you. If you lifted your hand, would you come? In fact, everyone stand so it won't be quite as awkward. Just everyone stand together. But those of you who lifted your hand, would you let me pray for you here? Would you just come on? So many hands were lifted. Come on. This is the grace. This is the approach. Just come right here to the front so I can pray for you if you don't mind. Thank you for coming. Thanks for coming, ladies. God bless you. Thank you for coming. Thank you. Thanks for coming. Thanks for coming. It's time to trust in Jesus. It's time to trust in Jesus. Who else? Come on. Thanks for coming. Thanks for coming. Gabe, if you got a song, sing a song if you don't mind. Thank you. Thanks for coming.
Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending,
come on,
reckless love, God. Oh, it chases me down, fights to the ground, leaves 99. I couldn't earn it. I don't deserve it. Still, you gave yourself. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Sing it one more time.
Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm out, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn, I don't deserve. Still you gave yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Is there anyone else who would like to join this group? We're about to pray. I'd love to pray for you. Anyone else who would like to join us? Guys, thanks for being honest with God. It's the only way to move forward with God is to be honest with him. You're honesty speaks volumes right now. Do you mind just lifting your heart up with your hands? Could we just do that? Just all over the house, everyone. Just lift your heart with your hands. Let's pray this prayer together. How about everyone pray this prayer? Dear Jesus. Dear Jesus. I've missed the mark. I can't have the life I need without you. I'm sorry that I decided to live without you. But today, because of your great grace, I'm coming back to you. Forgive me of my sins. I promise to stop trusting in the things. With the help of the Holy Spirit, I'm going to trust in you. You are my source of life. Today I turn and I follow you. Today I become your follower, Jesus. Lead my life. Fill my life with your purpose. Thank you for loving me in spite of myself. In Jesus' name.